This afternoon, 17,490 rabid basketball fans were on hand here at Market Square Arena in the heart of downtown Indianapolis to watch what was originally a field of 395 cut to the final two. And those final two teams are on hand here again tonight to battle for the 1982 Indiana High School Athletic Association Basketball Championship. Tonight's high school basketball showcase features the Plymouth Pilgrims, now 27-1 on the year, following their hard-fought 62-59 victory over the Indianapolis Cathedral Irish against the Panthers of Gary Roosevelt, victorious in a scintillating 58-57 shootout with number one ranked and previously unbeaten Evansville Bossy. Hello again, everybody. I'm Jerry Baker. 17,000 plus on hand again tonight at Market Square Arena for the grand finale of what has been a sensational high school basketball season. The Plymouth Pilgrims of Jack Edison are 27-1 on the season. A winner over, as we mentioned, Indianapolis Cathedral this afternoon. A ballgame in which they were always in charge despite being totally outmanned height-wise along that front line. Scott Skiles had 30 points today, hitting 11 of 21 field goals, 8 of 12 free throws. He also had 7 rebounds to lead the ball club in that capacity also. The tallest starter on this ball club is 6 feet 2 inches tall. Again tonight, they'll be outmanned in that capacity. They were out-rebounded 38-26 by Cathedral and still got the victory. They have made some fans around the state of Indiana, many here at Market Square Arena, believers. Gary Roosevelt Panthers have Ron Heflin 22-5. Winning it on a final shot by Renaldo Thomas with no time left. Tonight's ball game, interesting matchup. Plymouth and Gary Roosevelt. Joe Section, Hilliard Gates, and I will return to Market Square Arena in just a moment. One of your network sponsors is American Fletcher National Bank. Center Grove High School Trojan Guard, under the direction of Thomas and Connie Dirks. The Guard, in its second-year performance, was awarded third place in the State Military Guard Championship last weekend. The particular group you're seeing right now has participated in 10 contests in the past 2 years, has achieved the enviable record of 6 first-place wins, 2 second-place trophies, and 2 third-place finishes. This 22-member unit, made up of volunteers who are instrumentalists in the Center Grove High School band program, will run a show that was specially designed for tonight's championship game by Robin Shaw, the Center Grove High School Trojan Guard.
Being joined at the West Basket by the cheerleaders of the Indiana School for the Deaf. They will proudly sign the national anthem. We ask you to join with Chuck Owens on the Market Square Arena organ as we salute the United States of America with the playing and singing of our national anthem. Thank you.
group of young ladies you just saw were the cheerleaders from the Indiana School for the Deaf, located here in Indianapolis. Judy Trojan of Greenwood, Kim Trojan of Greenwood, David Koski of Brownsburg, Gigi Bartholomew of Kokomo, Shannon Maple of Newcastle, and Karen Satterley of Valparaiso, Indiana. They live in a dorm on campus during the school year, the Indiana School for the Deaf. So we're getting set for tonight's starting lineup for the state championship in Indiana high school basketball. We'll return to Market Square Arena in just a moment. One of your network sponsors is Farm Bureau Insurance. Man who's had a simply sensational career at Plymouth High School. He'll wear number 22, a 6'1 senior, Scott Skiles. He averages 28.8. He had 30 points this afternoon on 11 of 21 shooting from the field, 8 of 12 at the free throw line. Skiles has scored 79 points in his last three games. He needs 18 more to become Plymouth's all-time leading scorer. Steve Phillips holds the record at Plymouth of 1766. Skiles has 1749. For the Plymouth Pilgrims, Scott Skiles. Now, here is the young man who sent the entire city of Gary, indeed the entire Calumet area, into ecstasy this afternoon when he hit that shot with no time left on the clock. Number 13, Renaldo Thomas. 6'4", senior, averaging 17.9. He had only 13 points today. Nonetheless, the final two were the big ones. He had 6 out of 13 from the field, 1 out of 3 from the free throw line. Renaldo Thomas, the 6'4", senior. Both ball clubs have now returned to the floor, and I got to say something before we go any further. It has nothing to do with the game itself. Hilliard, you've been doing this longer than I. Joe's been around it longer than I. But every time I see the presentation of the colors, the way it's done tonight, right, and the playing of the national anthem, the goosebumps are still there.
Well, that's what sports really is all about, I guess. This is the great democracy, the great republic, and sports plays an integral part of the philosophy of that kind of a nation. And incidentally, that reminds me of the great youth here in Indianapolis that plays basketball here today, and the great young people in Fort Wayne, Indiana, that came through when our city was threatened a week ago Wednesday night. And thousands of young people met the challenge. It wasn't a basketball game, it wasn't a football game, but they met the challenge, and we congratulate them.
We were, of course, a distant from that hill. You're not affected directly by that, but we saw the television coverage, and your young ladies and gentlemen in that part of the city, part of the state, are to be commended. They were simply outstanding in their efforts. Well, we're set to go now with tonight's basketball game. Let's swing across the floor once again for the introduction of tonight's rosters. Here is Tom Carnegie.
Presenting the starting combination for first, the Panthers of Gary Roosevelt. At the forwards, number 14, Darrell Scott. Number 13, Renaldo Thomas.
Thomas is that 6'4 senior who had the winning bucket today, averaging 17.9. He had 13 this afternoon.
The center, number 24, Ronnie Bradley.
Bradley is 6'2 and a half senior, averages 5.5, and he had 6 today.
The guards, number 3, Winston Garland.
He played very well today, did Winston Garland, a 5'10 junior, scoring 9 points, had 7 assists this afternoon.
Number 5, David Dorsey.
5'10 senior, the other guard, averages 10 per, had only 4 today.
And the coach, Ronald Heflin.
Ron now with a record of 121 wins and 46 losses in his 8th year as the head coach of the Panthers of Gary Roosevelt High School.
Now for the Plymouth Pilgrims. At the forwards, number 20, Todd Samuelson.
Todd, a 5'11 junior, did not score today, but he had 6 assists and 4 important steals.
Number 42, Barry Peterson.
Barry is a 6'2 senior, right on his scoring average today. He scored 6 points.
The center, number 34, Ronald Sissel.
Played exceptionally well. Did Ron Sissel, 6'2 senior, scored 10 points today.
And the guards, number 12, Philip Wendell.
Phil is a 5'11 senior, had only 8 points, but also leads the team in assists. Very important there.
And number 22, Scott Skiles.
Scott, a 6'1 senior, 28.8, had 30 points. He is something else to watch.
The coach, Jack Edison.
Jack is in his ninth year at Plymouth High School. Record of 148 wins, 65 losses. He's won 5 sectionals, 2 regionals, and 1 semi-state.
He was the assistant under Steve Yoder, and when Steve went to Ball State, he took over. In fact, Jack Edison has been coaching at Plymouth for 16 years total.
Steve Wilmer on your left there, and Wayne Van Sickle doing the championship game. They got him all right.
We got him right
today. We're going to be all right today.
It's kind of an inside joke, Hilliard. The last three games that Joe and I have done, we've had the names wrong. And so far, no officials yelled at us as of yet. I'll tell you what, they better leave big Steve Wilmer alone. How big a guy is he, Joe?
He has to be 6'8 or 9, doesn't he?
You know him, I guess, up from a few years gone by.
Excuse me, Joe, go ahead.
No, that's right, go ahead, Hilliard.
I was going to say that if we didn't get him right tonight, we'd have the technical.
Man. All right, we're set to go now. When you take a look at the Market Square Arena scoreboard, the score on the left will be Plymouth. On the right-hand side, of course, Gary Roosevelt. Plymouth is the home team tonight. The Pilgrims just in their white uniforms, trimmed in red. Their school colors are crimson and white. Gary Roosevelt, black and gold. And as Ron Heflin said, the coach of Gary Roosevelt, he breathes black and gold. The tap is controlled by Gary Roosevelt. Number three is Winston Garland. He and David Dorsey are the guards. Ronnie Bradley is in the pivot. Ronaldo, Thomas, and Darrell Scott are the forwards. Knocked away, and there's those quick hands again by Plymouth, already in the ballgame. First turnover, here is Skiles giving it inside to Wingle, and it's a two-point lead for Plymouth. If you have not seen Plymouth play, stick around. They are an interesting ball club to watch.
First few minutes, 3 minutes, ought to be very important here.
Ronaldo Thomas getting his first two of the game. We're tied at two for the first time. Wendell missing. Oh, he did get it. Got the roll. Phil Wendell with two field goals on two out of two shooting. So three shots have gone up. Three have gone in. And it's a 4-2 basketball game with a minute gone in the first period. This is for all the marbles in Boys State High School basketball in the great state of Indiana. Garland looking for help. His 20-minute guard is David Dorsey. This is Dorsey. Good position on the rebound from Barry Peterson. Joe Sexton, I'm amazed the way Plymouth boxes out with no more heights than they have.
Well, they must do that or else they don't have a chance on the board.
Bad shot that time by Skiles. In a hurry comes Gary Roosevelt. High ball game again as Ronaldo Thomas gets his second bucket of the night. Thomas shoots 48% on the year. It's about where he was this afternoon on 6 out of 13.
Both teams are playing a man-to-man defense. Barry Peterson has drawn the assignment of Ronaldo Thomas.
Good move by Skiles. He missed the shot. But the foul was tabbed on David Dorsey. That'll be the first on him. It'll be a shooting violation. That means Scott Skiles will go to the line.
Let's watch David Dorsey now. There's a fake by Scott Skiles, number 22. Right there's the shot. Put him on the arm.
Skiles earlier this week, as we come back live, was named to the United Press International All-State Team. He'll probably be on every All-State Team they come up with. He had 30 points in the semi-state finale against South Bend LaSalle last Saturday night. A week ago tonight in that big win.
There's some big-time college coaches in the audience tonight. His performance this afternoon widened their eyes a little bit more.
Giles, a 77% free throw shooter. 8 out of 12 from the free throw line today. He is 2 out of 2, and Plymouth goes back in front now, 6 to 4. We've had two ties, 1 at 2, 1 at 4. Roosevelt has yet to get the lead. Thomas missing, and there's the rebound by Scott Skiles. They fill the lanes beautifully. It's tapped away, I believe. Garland got a hand on it. Oh, he turned it over on a good defensive play from Todd Samuelson, who I think may have thought he committed a personal foul, but instead he caused the turnover.
Plymouth is really breaking here, and I'm a little bit surprised at the tempo they're establishing.
Well, I got a suspicion. Now, check me out on this, Coach. They might want to see if they can run Roosevelt since they played the second game today.
If they think they have that advantage, if they think that it is an advantage to play the first game, I'm sure that's a possibility. But Hilliard and I were talking, Jerry, before the game. They'll sneak around on a fast break a little more often than you think.
Turnover by Plymouth gives the ball back to Gary Roosevelt. We are at 6-4 now. Plymouth got it but by two. And a whistle away from the ball as it goes into the middle. And a reaching in foul is called on Phil Wendell. And it's number one on Phil. It's a common foul. No shots involved. So Gary Roosevelt will inbound beneath their own hoop. That is the coaching staff across the way of the Plymouth Pilgrims. Head coach Jack Edison. Mike Pettibone out of Ball State's the varsity assistant. Tom Eisenbarger from Butler is the JV assistant. Garland Winston Garland getting his first two of the day. He had 9 points, 2.5 points above his scoring average. We are tied for the third time of this ball game at 6. 5:25, first period. Capacity crowd on hand, or nearly so, at Market Square Arena. Skiles wanted it, couldn't get it. Wendell tries it, couldn't get it there either. Good rebound position that time by Ron Sissel. Quickly up court it comes to Dorsey. Not a particularly good shot. Dorsey goes to the floor hard. And Sissel's got it right side. I think I gave him credit for the rebound for Roosevelt. It should have been Bradley. And Plymouth goes back in front by two again. Both of the cheering sections are directly behind Hilliard and Joe and I. And they're really making some noise. Dropped inside and taken away again by Scott Skiles. They try to go to Bradley. Quickly up front right side, Samuelson. At Plymouth, that's its biggest lead now at 4 points at 10-6. And well, I'll tell you, Joe, I don't know if it's by design or not, but they are getting that baby out and humming it up the court.
There's no doubt. They must feel that the coaching staff must feel that they are able to run the Panthers. Now, the big problem will be to get the basketball to run them, but they've been doing a pretty good job so far.
Double dribble, turn it over again. If you were not with us earlier today, the game between Evansville Bossy and Gary Roosevelt, from the time they came on the floor to warm up to the time they walked off at the end of the final buzzer, they ran and ran and ran. That may be one of the reasons that Jack Edison's got his ball club out running hard. 3 minutes and 55 seconds to play in the first period. It is Gary Roosevelt trailing by 4, 10-6. Almost a turnover. It'll be covered by Samuelson. Now what is a turnover? Here comes David Dorsey behind the back and up and no good. Missed shot from Ronaldo Thomas. And a 2-on-1 break in Plymouth, who just must refuse to the game plan and talk him out of it. Samuelson from outside has his second bucket of the night. And it's a 12-6 basketball game. Plymouth on in front by 6 and timeout called by Gary Roosevelt. With a score 12-6, Plymouth over Roosevelt. One of your network sponsors is Farm Bureau Insurance. Shooting percentages early in the contest. Plymouth shooting 63%. Gary Roosevelt 43%. Not bad on either side of the ledger. But right now it's been Roosevelt hustling to get back on defense. Plymouth taking it right at him. They force Garland into the middle and knock it away from him. Samuelson, they fill the lanes. Near side, Skiles, bump, gets it across the way. Up and good, and that's Phil Wendell's third bucket of the night. Wendell now with a half a dozen points. Unselfish move by Scott Skiles, who also passes pretty well, Coach. He's noted as a shooter, but he also gives the ball up pretty well.
Yes, he's got two of the assists to Phil Wendell already here in his first quarter.
8-point lead for Plymouth, 14-6. Not anymore. Ronaldo Thomas getting his third bucket of the contest. Thomas, a good shooter at 48%, but very quickly, Plymouth gets back up court, and the foul is called on Ronnie Bradley. Maybe it's time, Joe, for you to comment on this. You said it during the timeout. Roosevelt's just not getting back on defense.
No, they certainly aren't. They probably anticipated they'd be able to rebound better on their offensive board, and they haven't been doing that. Plymouth has been doing a real good job, and they're looking up the floor on every opportunity that they get the basketball.
Phil Wendell is in the top 7% of a senior class academically. Indiana Basketball Coaches Association All-Academic Team for 1982. Young man's a good student in addition to being an outstanding basketball player. He has 7 points, looking for 8. Plymouth is 4 out of 4 now from the free throw stripe. As a team, they shoot 73%. This afternoon, they hit 75% of their free throws. And it's a 16-8 lead again. Back to the 8-point differential. Ronaldo Thomas, rebound picked out by Plymouth again. An awfully strong, muscular move from Ron Sissel that time. Skiles, 14-footer. I believe, Hilliard, that's Skiles' first bucket of the game, is it not?
It is. He made 2 free throws earlier.
He has given the ball up, as Joe Sexton pointed out, very effectively. Here's the steal again. Barry Peterson, their 6'2 senior, took it away. Up quick, they go to Wendell. And Wendell now has 10 points. 4 field goals, 2 out of 2 from the line, and Plymouth is really doing a number on Roosevelt right now. They lead them 20-8 with a minute 52 to go in the first period. Plymouth can shoot the ball all night long. Garland gets it outside. Maybe that'll cool things down just a bit. Plymouth over the year averaged 75.9. This is a ball club with nobody taller than 6'2 in the starting lineup. They got a couple of subs, 6'4 and 6'6, but we didn't get a chance to see them today. A good move by Wendell again. Left-handed shot, no good. Follow-up won't go. The rebound in the middle by Ronaldo Thomas. Garland again. Left side, Dorsey. David Dorsey getting his first two. That cuts the lead down to 20-12. You gotta wonder, Joe, how long Plymouth can keep this pace up. Seconds, first period. Skiles in trouble. Threw the ball away. And that's one of the few bad plays we've seen Scott Skiles make today.
But only three personal fouls called in this game. Two against Gary Roosevelt, one so far against Plymouth.
Anthony Stewart coming off the bench now for Roosevelt. Joe, you might tell the people what he did this afternoon.
Well, Anthony came right out there and made about four baskets in a row. Ended up being the leading scorer.
It's right with 14 points. Did Anthony Stewart, a 5'11 junior. Here's the ball knocked away and a foul call. It's against Plymouth. And they are pointing.
That foul is on Plymouth's number 40.
On Barry Peterson, I believe.
What's a nice pass in here now to Bradley. Peterson comes over to help. Two-shot foul now for Bradley.
As we come back live, Ronnie Bradley goes to the free throw line for Gary Roosevelt. Bradley's a 38% shooter. They're just not a very good free throw shooting club. He was 0-for-1. And this afternoon's win over Evansville Bossy. Bradley had a brother, Jim, on the 1970 East Chicago Roosevelt State Championship Club. Missed them both. Rebound cleared out of there by Ron Sissel of Plymouth. 34 seconds to play, first period. Sissel, bring it back outside, long range to Samuelson and Skiles. 25 seconds and a half, first period. Skiles, great move. Skiles now with six. Out of 10 seconds to play in the first period. Oh, great defensive play that time by Plymouth. Loose ball on the floor. 4 seconds. Three. They can't see the scoreboard. Garland gets it away, and it's good, and it counts. Winston Garland at the buzzer makes it a 22-14 ball game at the end of the first period. Plymouth leads. Gary Roosevelt, one of your network sponsors, is American Fletcher National Bank. Over Evansville Bossy. They won the Gary Sectional over Wallace and Wirt. Gary Regional beating Hammond and East Chicago Roosevelt on the West Lafayette Semi-State with a victory over Western Boone, Anderson-Madison Heights. Plymouth got here with a win in the Plymouth Sectional over Bremen and Argus. Plymouth Regional over Manchester at Elkhart Memorial, being down by 14 in the fourth period against Elkhart Memorial. Won the Fort Wayne Semi-State over two tough teams, Marion and South Bend LaSalle. And of course, earlier today, beat the Irish of Indianapolis Cathedral High School. Well, the second period tap is controlled by Gary Roosevelt. After one period, it's 22-14. Plymouth out in front. Lennon's going by Phil Wendell, who had 10. Roosevelt had just three players scoring, Garland and Thomas, each with six, two from Dorsey. Of course, Garland got that bucket right at the buzzer to pull them to within eight. Put back up and good by Ronaldo Thomas. Thomas now with 8 points. Drop the lead to six now. Plymouth had a lead as high as 12 in the first quarter. They look just sensational.
Well, a defensive change now for the Panthers. They've gone to that 1-2-2 defense that they used in the fourth quarter this afternoon.
Whoa, Skiles was looking to go to the shot, and Wendell was going to the board. Skiles changed his mind. Went to Well Farrell was. He was no longer there, so the turnover gives the ball back to Gary Roosevelt.
Plymouth hitting 69%, 9 of 13. Gary Roosevelt, 7 out of 12, 58%.
Pretty good shooting. Roosevelt basketball with Anthony Stewart. No good this time. Rebound pulled off by Plymouth. Larry Peterson. Skiles to Wendell in the corner and back to Skiles. Here is Wendell. And Skiles about 20 feet out. Out of the bottom and out of cover. Ronaldo Thomas, 3-on-2. Skiles is back. Wendell is back. Wendell got him and the bucket will not count. Oh, my. Oh, my.
They want that one.
Yeah, take a look at this, coach.
All right, fine. Ronaldo Thomas taking it on the drive now. There's Phil Wendell right there. He's up in the air. Could very well have given him that basket.
Inbounds pass to Garland. Hey, whip it around to the weak side, which isn't weak very long the way this Plymouth ball club plays. In the middle, Thomas, no. Rebound on the floor, put back up, and finally is good by Ronnie Bradley. Bradley getting his first two of the game. Bradley, a senior, standing 6'2 and a half. We commented on his weight this afternoon. He's got a lot of that to move around, but he gets the job done very well. Over the back, as Skiles stopped right at midcourt. And Stewart could not stop, so Anthony picks up his first. Team's third. He'll inbounds it middle court across the way.
Gary, the last time down the floor was the first time that the Roosevelt Panthers showed their offensive rebounding prowess. And they got two of them and finally got it in the hole.
Keep an eye on this Plymouth ball club and see if they're going to run out of gas. Well, they came out like a house of fire. Wendell. Oh, Samuelson or Peterson trying to drop it inside. And just simply threw it over the outstretched arms of the intended receiver. And maybe it's my imagination, Joe, but it looks like Plymouth may be dropping down a notch in speed.
They certainly are. They're all breathing pretty heavy out there right now.
5:40 to go on the half. 22-18. Plymouth not in front. They've led by as many as 12. Game was tied three times at 2, 4, and 6. And since then, it has gone off Plymouth. That is Anthony Stewart. He had 6 out of 11 from the field this afternoon and led Gary Roosevelt coming off the bench with 14 points.
8 straight Roosevelt points here.
5:15 to go in the half. Lead that once was 12 has been chopped to 2. Peterson in trouble, throws it back to Skiles again. Got a perimeter offense line out there now, Joe. They're not making any penetration effort at all.
Yeah, they did this a little bit this afternoon.
Nice play to no avail and a foul indeed on Ron Sissel, number 1 on him, and the 4th against the Plymouth Pilgrims.
All right, let's see. There's a backdoor play right there. There goes Skiles up for the shot. And then there's Sissel coming over the back right there.
It's a good play, Joe, but nothing, wasn't a very, very good shot. It was an open shot, but he just didn't shoot it very well.
This afternoon, they did it a little bit. It's just to get their offense started, to hang on the ball a little bit, and then they go back door and try to hit Skiles or Wendell.
You pointed out earlier in the game today with Plymouth and Cathedral that Skiles was not hitting that corner shot early, but he got it going late in the contest, later on in the contest.
Sure did.
22-20, trying to tie it. Good position on the rebound, put back up, and it's still worth ball. Finally tapped up and good by Ronnie Bradley. Bradley has his first 2 buckets of the night. They've all come in the quarter. And Hilliard, the spring has run out to how many now for Roosevelt? They've run up.
They've run 10 straight points off.
A great strong move by Scott Skiles, getting his 8th of the game. Ball game again as Anthony Stewart answers the call at the other end of the floor. Ball game tied at 24. 5th time it has been tied. 3:55 to go. First half, and the Pilgrims throw it away again. Plymouth is not the kind of a ball club that makes very many errors and a very disciplined offense, but they're seemingly having some troubles right now.
Well, what they're doing now is they're trying to force it. Earlier in the game, they had a numbers advantage on Gary Roosevelt. Now they do not. Gary's getting back, but they're still trying to force it a little bit.
They'll block out underneath with Scott Skiles. Skiles is trying to run the offense. He keeps yelling for some of his teammates to come out and help him out of that guard spot. 3.5 minutes to go in the half. 24 tie. After Plymouth was ahead by 12, they have now come into a tie situation. You see Skiles directing traffic. Five to go, first half. 24 tie. Plymouth in white. Gary Roosevelt in the black uniform. That substitution is Jamie Johnson, number 50, a 6'4 sophomore. Played this afternoon and scored 8 points. Almost lost it to Johnson. Manages to find a handle on it. Down to 2:40 to play in the half. Samuelson goes back to Scott to Wendell. He got it to Sissel, and Ron's got his second bucket at 4 points. They worked it well. Took a long time to get there, but they got the job done. Number four is Andre Anders, who's in the lineup now for the Gary Roosevelt Panthers. Foul is called on Phil Wendell, and I've got it for three. They may not have any choice, though. They may have to go to the bench here.
Here's Anthony Stewart now taking charge again. A nice drive. There's Phil Wendell reaching in.
Here comes the substitution. It'll be Mark Stukenberg.
Stukenberg,
who played today. Very limited action. Did not score. Number 44, 6'2 junior. Phil Wendell going out, as you see, with three personal fouls. And here is Anthony Stewart at the free throw line. The Gary Roosevelt Panthers.
We have him down for 91%. He would be the best free thrower on the team. He hasn't taken all that many, however.
Hit two out of three in the win this afternoon over Evansville Bossy. 26-25. Plymouth out in front. They're looking to tie for the sixth time. And the rebound instead comes down to Scott Skiles. S-K-I-L-E-S. Make note of that. This young man may have a tremendous college future in front of him. 2 minutes, 2 seconds to go, first half. 26-25, Plymouth, 12-point lead, dwindled down to one. Indeed, it was tied about a minute ago. Not really a four-corner, Joe, but it kind of has some similarities.
Yes, and they play someone in the opposite side wing. When the ball's on one side of the floor, somebody will break into the high post, and then they'll go behind their man for a backcourt.
1:35 to go in the half. 1 point lead for Plymouth, 26-25. If you're letting a 12-point lead get away from it.
Is this as much to rest as anything else?
Well, I think they were losing the tempo of the game there when the Panthers went on their roll. And so now they can rest, but they can also dictate who shoots this ball. Only Wendell or Skiles will have the first opportunity to shoot. Now, the last time, Wendell had a chance, but he dumped it off. Right at the basket.
We have come down to exactly 1 minute to play in the first half. It was 22-14. At the end of the first period, Plymouth had a lead. It's now 26-25. That was really the kind of scoring that Plymouth has come up with. Only 4 points here in this period. Skiles, yes. And Joe called it. They wanted Skiles to take it. He got it. Scott now with 10. He and Wendell each have 10, though Phil got all 10 of his in the first quarter. 40 seconds remain. First half. 3 point lead, Plymouth, 28-25. Andre Anders, not free. All called against Plymouth.
It'll be charged, I believe, to Ron Sissel. That would be number two.
And on Ron, that is number two. Correct, Hilliard. And now we'll go to the free throw line. The former number 13. Ronaldo Thomas, UPI All-State team this week, the only starter back from last year's Gary Roosevelt Ball Club. In fact, he is a four-year starter for the Panthers.
Fortunately, he didn't have to make the team by free throw shooting.
Well, he's one out of six today.
A 28-25 lead, three-point differential. 19 seconds to play. Plymouth has the lead. Pilgrims have the basketball, and they're cheering Sexton just going bonkers behind us back there. They've been yelling for about an hour now. About 8 seconds to go. Scoreboard at Marcus Garina is tough to see while you're on the floor. Outside shot is good. And the first couple of points of the game for Mark Stukenborg. His first two gives Plymouth a five-point lead at halftime. Halfway through the state championship game, it's Plymouth 30, Gary Roosevelt 25. We'll be back with some very special halftime ceremonies for you in just a moment. First, one of your network sponsors is Farm Bureau Insurance.
The runner-up medallions are being presented at halftime to the teams defeated in the afternoon round, Indianapolis Cathedral and also Evansville Bossy. Quickly, the scoring for the Plymouth Pilgrims. Todd Sanderson has four. Barry Peterson did not score. Ron Sissel has four. Phil Wendell with 10, all in the first period. Got into foul problems, is out of the lineup at the moment. Scott Skiles, 10, and Mark Stukenborg getting the final 2 points of the first half for Plymouth, leading 30-25. For Gary Roosevelt, Renaldo Thomas has 8. Darrell Scott did not score. Ronnie Bradley, 4. Winston Garland, 6. David Dorsey, 2. And 5 points all in the second period off the bench by Anthony Stewart. Unusual scoring pattern of the ball game as Plymouth went out to an early lead. They got on top 20-8, and finally Roosevelt came back and Gary tied the count at 24-24. Plymouth regained lead 26-24, 28-25, and the final basket of the first half, Mark Stukenborg at the end of the first half has made the final score at halftime here, 30-25 in favor of Plymouth. One of your network sponsors is American Fletcher National Bank.
Harry Playmore. Mark Reels. Jeff Chestnut. David Hendrick. Tim
30-25, Plymouth over Gary Roosevelt halftime. The medallion presentation continues to the runner-up teams, Evansville Bossy. Presentations by Ginther Herzog, Fort Wayne Concordia, chairman of the IHSAA Executive Committee, and David J. Herbert of Mitchell. Cathedral presentations made by William L. Shepherd of Carmel High School, Don Elder Monroe Central assisting. Here's the ceremony with Tom Carnegie.
Athletic Director, Don Hess. Ladies and gentlemen, there they are, two great teams. Let's welcome them both. For the Irish of Cathedral and the Bulldogs of Evansville Boston. The Executive Committee of the IHSAA is pleased to have in attendance at the finals recipients of the coveted Gimbel and Truster Mental Attitude Award. The Mental Attitude Award has been presented each year since 1917 to a state finalist in grade 12 who was nominated by his principal and coach, and having excelled in mental attitude, athletic ability, scholarship and leadership during the 4 years of high school. Here tonight to greet this exclusive group of men, Ward Brown, the commissioner, Phil Askew, Commissioner Emeritus, and the members of the 1982 Executive Committee. I know you're going to be thrilled to see these great winners, but please hold your applause until all have been introduced. First, from Martinsville, the year 1917, Claude Curtis. Next, from Thorntown, the year 1919, Walter Cross. From 1920, Thorntown, or rather Bedford, Harold Laughlin. From Indianapolis Shortridge, the year 33, James Seward. From Jasper, the year 34, Arthur Gosman. From Richmond, the year 1935, James Leibold. From Evansville Bossy, the year 39, Jim Myers. From Madison, the year 41, Donald Serber. From Lebanon, the year 43, Dave Laughlin. Next, Robert Cripe of Florida, 1946. Pat Klein of Marion, 1950. Bob Jewell, Indianapolis Addicts, 51. From Tech High School, Joe Sexton, 1952. Terre Haute Gerstmeyer, Harley Andrews, 1953. 1954, Bobby Plump, Milan. From Lafayette Jeff, Robert Perrigo, 57. From Crawfordsville, Richard Haslam, 58. From Kokomo, 59, Jimmy Rail. From East Chicago, Washington, 1960, Robert Cantrell. From Garfield of Terre Haute, 63, Greg Samuels. From 64, it's Huntington's Michael Weaver. Next, from Washington, Eddie Bopp, Washington of Indianapolis, the year 65. 1967, Fort Wayne, Southside, Charles Nelson. 1968, from Gary Roosevelt, James Nelson. From the year 1970, Lagoni's James Trout. Next, from Newcastle, the year 71, Jerry Lamberson. From Franklin High School, the year 1973, Gary Aplanum. Next, Don McLaughlin, Franklin, 1974. 1980, from Marion, Jeff Todd. And finally, from a year ago, 1981, Vincennes Lincoln's Carl Donovan. Now they're all in formation. There they are, from over the years, the Gimbal and Tester Award winners who accepted the invitation. Some of the greats in high school basketball. Let's give them a salute.
A standing ovation from 17,400 basketball fans for the Gimbel and Tester Award winners. A mighty impressive ceremony. Last February, in the IHSAA Girls Tournament, the parade of girls champions over the preceding decade. Equally impressive then as this ceremony is tonight. Halftime, it is Plymouth 30 and Gary Roosevelt 25 in the state championship game. We'll be back in just a moment. One of your network sponsors is Farm Bureau Insurance.
For the Plymouth Pilgrims, they are led in scoring by Phil Wendell and Scott Skiles, are outstanding guards, each with 10 points. You see that Phil Wendell, though, has picked up that third personal foul. Sissel and Samuelson, each with 4. And Mark Stukenborg off the bench has the other 2 points. That's the Plymouth scoring in the first half. For the Gary Roosevelt Panthers, they're scoring somewhat better balanced, I guess. Ronaldo Thomas with 8. Winston Garland with 6. They had 5 points off the bench from Anthony Stewart, 4 out of Ronnie Bradley, 2 out of David Dorsey. The other starting forward, Darryl Scott, did not score. Nobody, as you can see, in any serious foul trouble, as Roosevelt committed only 3 personal fouls in the entire first half. Now, here are the first half team statistics for the Panthers. On your left, they're hitting 12 out of 23. That's 52%. 1 out of 5 from the free throw line for a very miserable 20%. For Plymouth, 13 of 19 for a remarkable 69%. 4 out of 4 for a perfect effort from the free throw line. Rebounds, 11 to 10 in favor of Plymouth. They are being led by Barry Peterson and by Scott Skiles, each with 3. Ronaldo Thomas has 5 for the Gary Roosevelt Ball Club. Turnovers are 6 and 8. Plymouth turned the ball over 8 times. And in the assist bracket, you can see that Plymouth moving the ball very well. 8 assists, with 4 of those belonging to Skiles, 3 to Phil Wendell. Halftime score again, 30 to 25. Plymouth and Quap, after leading by as many as 12, indeed ahead by 22 to 14 at the first quarter stop. Joe Sexton, I believe that you and Hilliard Gates touched on it. The big story of the second half, as far as we can tell, is going to be, can the Rabbit outrun everything else that's chasing him out there?
That's exactly right. That's a great way to put it, Jerry, because that's what they're up against right now. But they have a 5-point cushion. We have to keep that in mind. They are up by 5, so they can dictate the tempo.
Would you expect them, Joe, to start full steam ahead, or maybe they'll go to that slowdown offense a little bit?
I would expect them to start just like they did at the start of the basketball game.
Well, we shall see as number 42, Barry Peterson, a 6'2 senior for Plymouth, will step in to jump against 6'4 senior Ronaldo Thomas, the leading scorer for the Panthers of Roosevelt.
Wendell is back in, Joe, and I noticed the Plymouth ball players seem to get their color back. They seem to be a little more pink.
Second half tip controlled by Gary Roosevelt, looking to pick up their 23rd win of the year against five defeats. They had the worst record coming into the Final Four, but they're playing for the title. Plymouth is 27-1 after the victory over Indianapolis Cathedral earlier today. Over the shoulder, Joe, you've talked about this a dozen times in the last 3 weeks, 4 weeks you and I have worked together.
Yes, sir. We got David Dorsey going to go over the shoulder here of Scott Skiles. You can see.
Automatic foul. That is on Anthony Stewart, foul number two. It's only the fourth against the ball club in the entire game in the first of the second half. So as much movement as we have had up and down the floor, they have still only committed four fouls in the entire game. 30 seconds into the third period. 30-25 Plymouth. They come to the near side, off the glass and short by Samuelson, and a rebound picked out by Ronaldo Thomas. Roosevelt on the run. Whoop, they lost it away. No foul, just a loose ball out of bounds that belongs to Plymouth. Ronaldo Thomas, you see on your screen, had 38 slam dunks this year, and he is quite an athlete. He had 25 points against Anderson-Madison Heights in that West Lafayette semi-state championship game of a week ago tonight.
Scott Skiles was looking at the officials, signaling offensive foul. He couldn't believe none was called.
Skiles has got it to the free throw line, went to get the rebound, and alertly stayed away from the foul as the rebound came down to Anthony Stewart. We played a minute here in the second half, but nobody has scored yet. Plymouth, in that first period, had a 12-point lead. They were on a tear. And then things kind of cooled down, and as we pointed out, they ran out of steam. Stewart, no. Good position on the rebound. Put back up and good by Ronnie Bradley. Bradley now with a 6-point. He averages 5.5 per. He had 6 this afternoon. Bill Wendell, no place to go. Back outside to Skiles. Skiles is having some trouble right now. He just is not shooting very well. In the first half, Skiles at 4 out of 7. That's over 50%.
Might have been a violation of the timeline there.
Well, they've changed their rule a little bit this year. You got to really watch that timeline situation. Not quite like it used to be. Winston Garland, now with 8. He had 6 points in the opening period. Was given the old goose egg in the second 8 minutes of play, so he has 8. His average is 6.5 per. He had 9 in the win over Evansville Fossey today. It's a 30-29 ball game. And now, all of a sudden, Roosevelt's got a chance to get their first lead of the game. Oh, great move by Anthony Stewart. Well, Joe, I don't know how they kept this guy out of the starting lineup.
Well, maybe he's better coming off the bench.
He has been sensational in this tournament. It is now a 1-point lead for Gary Roosevelt at 31-30. As they have outscored Plymouth 6-0 here in this third period. I'm double-checking, and I don't think that any time in the first half did Gary Roosevelt have a lead. Well, they did not. That's the first time right there. They have really bottled up Scott Skiles. As a matter of fact, well, I thought they'd call a foul on David Dorsey. Dorsey ran Skiles clear off the floor. Now he's picked up the foul. I don't know if we can possibly isolate on that, but keep an eye on number 5, David Dorsey of Roosevelt, and Scott Skiles, number 22 of Plymouth. Joe, I saw the official talking to Dorsey as Skiles went clear off the end of the floor down there. I thought maybe I missed the whistle.
Well, it was kind of noisy, but I don't think Scott got knocked as hard as he
I think he may have done some acting. I agree, yes, but it is fierce. They're really trying to put the pressure on Skiles. They've got it in now to his running mate at guard, Bill Wendell. 5:11 to go, third period. Here is Skiles. Rebounded beautifully by Ronaldo Thomas. 1-point lead for Roosevelt, and they turn the ball over. Apparently, Thomas got it on his hip that time.
Exactly right. It got caught on his right hip, and he just couldn't handle it.
Seen that call 2 or 3 times today, as a matter of fact. Bill Wendell, the first team all-conference the last couple of years. Plymouth, he needs 41 points to reach the 1,000 point career plateau. He had only 8 today, so he's not likely to reach that. 4:54 to go, third quarter, 31-30 lead. Gary Roosevelt, whooped inside and threw it away. Todd Samuelson turned down about a 12 or 15 footer on the left side, trying to get it to somebody coming baseline and threw it over their head. Plymouth, I think, Joe, needs to get their act put back together again.
Yes,
just a
do.
Little bit.
He tried to hit Scott Skiles, cut to the basket, then just threw it a little too high.
Thomas forced the shot, rebounded by Skiles, who was the team's leading scorer and rebounder, 7.1 per game, and he had 7 in the today's win over Cathedral's Irish. Ball, 5 seconds.
Very good defense here by Gary Roosevelt.
It will not be a jump ball. It'll go over to Gary Roosevelt's. What is going to happen? And Plymouth wants timeout. 4:17 to play in the third quarter. And a 31-30 Gary Roosevelt lead. Plymouth still has not scored in the second half. We'll continue after this message.
Did I say that?
Along with Hilliard Gates and Joe Sexton, this is Jerry Baker, courtside at Market Square Arena, downtown Indianapolis, the state championship game. It's for all the marbles in high school basketball. 31-30 is the lead. Gary Roosevelt has got 2 more. Ronnie Bradley, now with 8. Bradley, a 5.5 per game score over the season will haul. There's the story on your screen, 3-point lead. That's the biggest for Roosevelt, and right now, they seem to be taking over this ball game. Into Skiles, he's got it, and he is fouled. And guess who got him? David Dorsey. We told you about that little battle. That's getting fierce down there.
Here's a nice pass, and Skiles goes back door. It's a pass from Wendell now. Watch this recovery now in body balance when he goes up. There's the foul on the arm right there.
The assistant coaches for Gary Roosevelt are Ronald Broom of Kentucky State, Glenn Miller of Kentucky State, and Benny Dorsey out of Wiley College. Benny Dorsey is David Dorsey's father. And he has just gone out of the lineup. There he is right there. He'll go over and sit near dad on the bench. Skiles missing that free throw shot. He's a good shooter. He's 2 out of 2 to that point of the game. Scott now with 12 points. That field goal he made, by the way, was the first for Plymouth in the second half. So they went about a little over 4 minutes without scoring. Strong power move by Renaldo Thomas again. It to me like, Joe, that Thomas wants the basketball right now.
He certainly does, and they're looking for him. And because Plymouth is tired, they're not covered up inside.
Skiles missed it. Having to get it back. Over to Samuelson, and now it goes over to Skiles. Wait a minute, guard Phil Wendell. Wendell takes it in for the 12-footer. Wendell getting his first bucket since the opening period of play. Now he has 12 points. He had 10 in the first quarter. Up and over. And give the hoop to Darryl Scott, his first 2 tonight. The fans aren't buying that little act, but he got it anyway, and the officials were right on top of it. Wendell again. 14 for Phil. Make it 37-36. Roosevelt lead at 1 with 2.5 minutes to play. 2:35, third period. Well, they are putting them up from everywhere. Last touch by Gary Roosevelt's Winston Garland. There was the head coach of the Gary Roosevelt Panthers, Ron Heflin, 43 years of age, married. He and his wife, Carla, have 2 youngsters, Kelly, 5, and Ron Jr., 3. Graduate of Gary Roosevelt High School, Tennessee State, and Indiana University. Now, here comes Roosevelt, 2-on-1. Excellent move that time to Renaldo Thomas, and a good no-call by the official. Never touched him. Stolen away by Garland. 3-on-2, Garland protects the ball as he had it knocked away from him, but he might be caught with a double dribble.
Earlier in the game, and in this afternoon's game, Plymouth would have recovered that ball, but they're so tired they cannot get to it. They cannot get to a loose ball.
Roosevelt played the second game, in case you didn't keep track of such a thing. And if anybody should be tired, it should be Gary Roosevelt, because they got caught in the track meet with Evansville Posse. But Hilliard, maybe some of that state championship track team is rubbing off on these guys here.
Right, and they're also deeper than Plymouth. They went to their bench pretty heavy in the afternoon game.
Hillian and I did the telecast of the state finals last year, a crack, and this Gary Roosevelt team is just super. There's a strong power move in time by Ronnie Bradley again, and Bradley, who had 4 points in the first half, has six in the third quarter, total of 10 and a foul call. It is on Darrell Scott, his first, the team's fourth in the second half, so as of yet, a common foul and no shots involved. We should point that out, Hillier, that the Gary Roosevelt track situation is just remarkable. Their records over the year are sensational in the world of track. And Ronaldo Thomas is the captain of that track team.
Right, and he was on the 400-meter winning relay team a couple of years ago that clinched the championship.
Defensive play knocks it away from Scott Skiles. Off the glass and good by Anthony Stewart. He has 9. Young man averages 5.5 per game, and now it is a 43-36 game with Gary Roosevelt just simply taking command. Foul call, Darrell Scott, that's 2 in a row on him. That is the 15th foul, so now we'll start the shots. Now that might be a factor here because Plymouth needs to get all the points they can get while that clock is stopped. With 35 seconds remaining in the third period, they trail by 7 points. Nobody's had, well, I shouldn't say that. Plymouth had a 12-point lead in the first period.
Last Saturday night, South Bend LaSalle led Plymouth 58-50 and lost the game.
Yeah, Plymouth is a good come-from-behind basketball team, but they're a very tired ball club right now. Skiles with 13 points. They beat Elkhart Memorial in the championship game of the Plymouth Regional after being down by 14 in the fourth period. You see Andre Anders coming back in the game. And last Saturday night, they won the Fort Wayne semi-state, beating South Bend LaSalle by 6, 77-71, after being down by 8 points in the fourth period. Also back in the lineup for Plymouth, number 44, Mark Stukenborg. Second of the bonus. Oh, they threw it away. The rebound came right down to the hands of Darrell Scott. And he had number 10, Jimmy Knowles. And number 4, Andre Anders, went out there, threw it at them, and nobody bothered to go get it. So the turnover gives the ball back again to Plymouth. Pilgrims have led all the way up until the final couple of minutes ago, and Rufus kind of caved him on it. Wendell. And his own rebound, puts it back up again. Rebounded by Skiles, blocked away, foul call. It is on Gary Roosevelt, and it'll be on number 24, Ronnie Bradley. That'll be 2 on him.
Here's a nice rebound here on this missed shot by Skiles. He's going to go up, and there's the foul right there, Bradley, number 24.
Scott Skiles is in the top 1/4 of his class academically. He was all conference in that Northern Lakes Conference the last 3 years. And as Hilliard mentioned earlier, he is an outstanding baseball player, all conference at shortstop the last couple of years in the Northern Lakes Conference. Two shots for Skiles.
Too tired.
I'm just going to ask you if that's a problem, Joe. He doesn't seem to be putting it up there with any kind of motion at all.
No extension.
Off the roll, Skiles now with 14 points. He had 10 of those in the first half. We're down to the final 10 seconds of period number 3, and it's 43-38. Gary Roosevelt with the lead. Got to grab a quick look at the scoreboard. Down to 3-2. And the corner, there he is, Anthony Stewart. Stewart with the 11. And with only 8 minutes left before we crown a champion, it's Gary Roosevelt 45, Plymouth 38. One of your network sponsors is Farm Bureau Insurance. Capacity crowd, you peer into the Gary Roosevelt cheering section. Indeed, the Panthers have a lot to yell about. Their ball club is up 45-38. They have 3 players scoring in double figures, led by Renaldo Thomas with Stewart off the bench with 11 and 10 from Ronnie Bradley. For Plymouth, 14 points each for Phil Wendell and Scott Skiles. And Joe Sexton, your observations as we win the final 8 minutes of this basketball game.
Well, the Panthers outscored the Plymouth Pilgrims 20 20-8 in that quarter, and they just look so tired. It'll be awfully hard for them to come back because they're going to have to get some rebounds to come back. The things that they have to do, you can't do when you're tired.
That's one of the moves right there they had to have. Skiles now with 16. Joe mentioned the 8 points, all eight of those points coming out of Phil Wendell and Scott Skiles. They put the eight, split it right down the middle, 4 points each. 45-40. Lead belongs to Gary Roosevelt. Next steal and 2 points for Scott Skiles. Awfully important. We go into the final 7.5 minutes of this basketball contest.
Now this double high post setup they have is the one they use to hold on to the ball. They also drop that high post man down to the basket occasionally, and we'll see if they're trying to wait to knock it in right at the basket or whether they're trying to hold on to the ball.
Well, apparently they want to talk things over. Ron Heflin called the timeout for Gary Roosevelt. There is your score with 7:03 to go in this basketball game. Back in a minute. One of your network sponsors, American Fletcher National Bank. Gary Roosevelt inbounding as you reach on his live at Market Square Arena. Backed away, fine defensive play by Skiles. 2-on-1, Skiles one side, Wendell the other. Skiles goes in, fouled on the act of shooting, and he got smacked high by Renaldo Thomas. That's number one on Renaldo Thomas. So Skiles will go back to the line, and he has not been very good there. Two out of his last five.
He's kept this ball here now. Watch him get rid of it so he gets two shots instead of just the 1-on-1.
He is an extremely intelligent player, as well as being a superb athlete, of course.
Plymouth has made 16 out of 32, 50%. Roosevelt, 22 out of 37, 59%.
He cannot get it to the basket.
He hit his first two, Joel. Now has hit two out of his last six. Points for Scotty at 30 this afternoon. The average is 28-8. Leads the team in scoring, rebound, and steals. With a full court pressure being employed now by Plymouth. That's going to take a lot of their energy. Steal again. Great play, Bill Wendell. Here they come. Skiles. Good move. All right. Skiles has suddenly come to life. He has scored all five of the points for Plymouth in the fourth period, and it's 45-43. They have outscored them 5-0 in this fourth period. 2-point lead, Roosevelt. 6:20 to go in this ball game, and they steal it again. So, Joe, they have reached down for that proverbial extra little bit of energy, and it's paying off so far. Stukenborg, cross-court pass to Samuelson. And a whistle. And the basket will not count. A foul called against Gary Roosevelt. And it looks like it's Ronaldo Thomas. And on Thomas at his personal foul number two.
Todd Samuelson makes a fake here, and there's Renaldo Thomas falling over him. Had Phil Wendell got that ball off, it would have counted, and then he would have shot a 1-on-1. It was a chance for a 4-point play, but he didn't get it off soon enough.
I'll tell you, Joey, just about the time we had given up on Plymouth, they're out of gas. They got nothing left. They found it somewhere.
Hilliard says you can't ever give up on this team, and he's right.
Samuelson. He is an 80% free throw shooter, did not go to the free throw line in the win over Cathedral this afternoon. Well, Todd, that's 5 points tonight. He did not score in this afternoon's game. His average is 5.1. Almost got his own rebound of a missed shot. 6:05 to go on this game. 45-44, Gary Roosevelt by one after being ahead by 7 in the third period and trailing by 12 in the first. Here's the steal again. Samuelson in on the layup, and he got it. Samuelson now with 7, and all of a sudden, Plymouth is going back in front by 1 and full court pressure and a foul. On Phil Wendell, that's 4.
That's the first team foul against Plymouth in the second half.
Indeed it is, Hilliard, and that's very important. unless it turns around on you. Is it Canada's situation where you need to foul to send somebody to the line? Right. But that is the first team foul against the Plymouth Ball Club in the second 16 minutes of play.
It really gives Plymouth a chance to take some chances here and foul them right now, which is not a bad idea against the Panthers.
Oh boy, they gave all the room in the world that time to Andre Anders, and he came up with his first 2 points of the contest. So it's 47-46, Roosevelt out in front by one. They've got it over to Wendell, little 12-footer. Bill Wendell with a 16-point total tonight. He had 8 points this afternoon, his average is 17.6. So just when it looked like Plymouth was ready to pull the covers up around their chin and go to sleep, they have come storming back to go in front by one with 5:05 to play. Power move inside, Ronnie Bradley. When he gets that close to the hoop, you can just go ahead and put him in the scorebook. He has 12 points. Inside 5 minutes. Oh, all alone underneath. They got it to Skiles, working the baseline. He may have stepped out of bounds, but he was fouled first. Foul is on Anthony Stewart, number three on Anthony, but more importantly, Plymouth gets a chance to go to the free throw line again. We mentioned earlier, Scott Skiles needed something in the neighborhood of 18 points to become Plymouth's all-time leading scorer. Skiles has 19, so he has just already surpassed that mark. Skiles now with 20. And Scott Skiles is now the all-time leading scorer at Plymouth High School, surpassing Steve Phillips. Well, he shot those a little better, Joe.
Much better.
Wet spot on the floor.
Plymouth has four times out remaining, and Gary Roosevelt was three, and that could be very important in the later stages of this game.
4 minutes and 48 seconds to play. Gary Roosevelt, which has been down by 12 in the first period, came back at halftime to trail by only five. Indeed, went ahead by seven as they outscored Plymouth 20-8 in the third period. And now they are down by one at 50-49 with the clock showing 4.5 minutes to play. Touched, I believe, by Phil Wendell. Good call to the official directly in front of my television vantage point. There is Phil, 5'11 senior. Neither he nor Skiles have been out of this basketball game today. They have really, really worked hard. And Wendell comes out of the heavy traffic with it. No advantage on the break. Loose ball, no foul as Thomas goes down. 2-on-2 at the other end. Great defensive play, but he still managed to get the hook to Anthony Stewart. Jamie Johnson made a great defensive play.
Wendell was injured. He went down hard and could not get back at the other end of the floor. As you see now, he's humped over. I can't tell whether it's the ankle. Yes, it's the left ankle he's pointing to.
Well, there was a tremendous collision over in that general area over there. Let's see if we can take a look at that again. You be the judge here.
Well,
Renaldo may have fallen on his ankle.
I think that's right.
He will stay in the lineup, though, apparently. A change now for Gary Roosevelt. Andre Anders, who was in there and went out, now will come back in, replace. Now Anders will go out, and Darryl Scott will come back in. The Plymouth guards remain the same. Bill Wendell, Scott Skiles, although Samuelson brings the ball up.
There's that 1-2-2 zone defense now again with Darryl Scott out on the point.
It is a 1-point lead for Gary Roosevelt, 51-50 with 3.5 minutes to play. Samuelson. He's had 5 points in the third and fourth period. He had only four total coming into the fourth quarter of play. 3:10 to go. Well, they make the move inside to Bradley. They seem to be trying to go to Bradley, Joe. He's just overpowering people in there.
Either Bradley or Renaldo Thomas, they kind of block across the lane for each other down low. They're doing a nice job of getting it in there now.
Three very close games today. All of them have been tight going into the last few moments.
Championship quality basketball in the greatest basketball state in the world. This shot, tap three, and tracked down brilliantly by Mark Stukenborg in the corner, deflected away and belonging to the Plymouth Pilgrims. Substitution now for Plymouth, coming back of the lineup, Ron Sissel, who has not been much of a factor offensively in this game, replacing Stukenborg.
He's had a long rest on the Plymouth bench.
Indeed he has. He'll be the freshest body out there. 2 minutes, 43 seconds to play, 53-52, Gary Roosevelt. Everything is on the line for the state championship. Good shot by Skiles. Now let's see if Roosevelt wants to cool things down a bit and put it in the deep freeze. They've got a one-point lead. They don't appear to be giving any indications of doing so. Anthony Stewart has played so very well all day long coming off the bench. He had 14 this afternoon. He has 13 tonight. Power play inside. Get two more to Renaldo Thomas. 14 for Renaldo. 8 in the first half, 6 in the second half of play. And the lead goes to 3 now at 55-52. Gary Roosevelt with a minute and 58 seconds to play for the state championship. Rebound, Darryl Scott. Now let's see what Roosevelt might do, Joe. They may just play a little keep away here. Take timeout first off. Timeout, Gary Roosevelt, 1:36 to play. They lead 55-52. Back in a minute, one of your network sponsors, Farm Bureau Insurance. Yesterday in Chest at the Kiwanis Club meeting, Tom Carnegie referred to Plymouth as a town whose power supply was a diehard battery. Now, he said it in Chest. They won't even need that tonight. They can operate off the electricity this ball club has created.
That's for sure.
Now, here comes the presentation of the championship trophy by Paul Rommelman of Counts, vice chairman of the IHSAA Executive Committee. Oh, there is a proud moment as the entire team gathers around that beautiful piece of art. All right, I will advise our friends up and down the network lines that we will stay on the air until 10:30. We want to get...
The committee has selected this year's recipient, and I would ask the parents to come and join in this moment. This year's selection for the Arthur L. Trester Award is... Philip Wendell of Plymouth.
He gets a little more composed and the photographers get some of their shots.
Philip Wendell is an honor student, wants to major in education, criminal justice, or business in college, made the academic All-State basketball first team, also a Law Day essay contest winner in Plymouth. Hilliard Gates is up on the platform with him, and we'll talk with him in just any moment, Hilliard.
His mother has just joined us down here, Philip. I watched you play last week in Fort Wayne. I saw you play magnificently here in Indianapolis all day and all night. I congratulate you. You're among the most deserved winners of this award that I've ever seen.
Thank you. I don't know what to say. I'm so happy. It's the best award I'll ever get. That's all I can say.
Well, it was a marvelous thing to win the championship and then get the double dip with this award.
It is. It's great. having your cake and eating it too.
Well, I know about your grade level back at Plymouth. I know how hard you work, and you're not only good in basketball, you're good in other sports, and I think that's magnificent. I congratulate you. Mrs. Wendell, congratulations.
Oh, thank you very much. I'm so happy and proud of Phil and the whole team.
When you can win a championship and also win the individual award, that's everything.
That's everything. And my family's right here.
Oh, bring them up here.
Okay.
Get them all up there, Wendell. Bring them all up there.
Where are they? These are people I don't know.
Phil's mother's name is Geraldine.
My daughter, Kathy Jones.
Hi, Kathy.
Hi.
Who else?
The oldest.
what a sight. What a view here. Who is this?
This is John.
Hi, John. Congratulations. Who's behind him there?
That's my oldest son, Don. And this is his twin brother, Paul.
Paul?
Phil's twin brother, Paul.
Well, you know, he looks like Todd Samuelson anyway.
Yeah.
The brother-in-law? We've got everybody here. There's nobody left in Plymouth. Congratulations, everybody. Congratulations. There it is, Jerry.
Well, Hilliard, I tell you what. There are a lot of things in sports that are not particularly nice, but this is one of those great moments, Joe, scoot over a little bit, when the families can get involved and they can somehow reap some of the rewards and benefits. And I know when your ball club was beaten, when Tech was beaten for the title, and you won the Prester Award, it didn't take a lot of the sting away, but you had to be very proud of yourself.
Well, I was, you know, happy about that, but it was a tough situation. I think the IHSAA deserves a lot of credit for involving the families here. I think that's a nice move that they make, and I think that really is good. And of course, they're always thinking about their right things to do.
On the screen is Scott Skiles. There's that. See the mark. Another very happy young lady on the floor right now with Hilliard Gates.
This is Judy Edison, wife of Jack Edison, the state championship basketball coach. Congratulations. You're overwhelmed.
Oh, I certainly am. I've just been praying for this all year.
Well, you've been toiling for 9 years as the wife of a head coach. Your husband has been on the staff for 16 years. I know how hard he's worked. I've seen him in Fort Wayne and other semi-states when he was the assistant to Steve Yoder, now at Ball State. And you've got to be so proud of him and these young men.
I am. I am very, very proud.
Did you ever give up hope here tonight? Kind of. Came close, didn't it?
I was a little worried.
Must have been the most sensational game you've ever seen.
It definitely was.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Judy.
Hilliard,
all right,
I
Jerry.
Think that, is that Lisa and Michael? They're youngsters.
Yeah, are Lisa and Michael here? Are you Michael? Congratulations, Mike. How old are you?
5.
And Lisa, how old are you?
9.
How do you feel right now?
Happy.
Congratulations. All right, Jerry.
All right, Hilliard. Lisa and Michael and the wife, Judy. Well, the crowd continues to mill at Market Square Arena. Over 17,000 were on hand again tonight. And I don't know how in the world, Joe, to recap a game like this. Okay. Help me if I blow something along the way here. Plymouth started out like a house of fire. In fact, that might have been a problem. They ran out of steam about halfway through the second period. They were up by 12 points in the first quarter. They led 22-14 after the opening period of play. At halftime, they were up by 5, 30-25, but I think the sign had been kind of set, Joe. They were beginning to run out of steam, and you brought up the point. Could they continue in the second half?
That's exactly right. We just felt that they had to reach down a little deeper if they possibly could, and we didn't know if they could. In fact, we counted them out at least once.
Oh, yeah. For the Plymouth fans, we didn't mean to upset you, but the fact of the matter was, at that point in time, they were all but finished. But somehow, they came back in the third quarter, trailed by 7. So indeed, at the end of 3 periods of play, we're down by 7, 45-38. And then, that's something that happens, and nobody can explain it. They found that extra burst of energy. They tied it on a Scott Skiles shot at the end of regulation time, 60-all. At the end of the first overtime, 65-all, and they win it 75-74. Skiles with 39 points.
But when you get behind like they were, and the reason that we were so convinced that they were going to have a hard time coming back and winning the state championship game was the fact that to get back in the game, first of all, you have to get some rebounds. Well, they're smaller to start with. Then you have to get some steals. Well, they're so tired they can't get a loose ball. We remarked about that during the game. So they couldn't get the loose ball. They couldn't get the steal. We didn't see any way how they were going to come back and, you know, to do what they had to do to get back in the game.
And they were, you could see in the motion, Skiles' free throw shot wasn't working for about a period.
Absolutely.
And then suddenly,
He got it back.
He found it again.
And he makes that, that had to be 20 feet, that jumper that yes. he hit to tie the ball game and send it into overtime.
And Plymouth sweeps it all. It's really the icing on the cake when you get the press award on top of everything else.
I think that's wonderful. And he certainly is a deserving young man.
Well, again, not to overlook Gary Roosevelt, this team, totally unheralded, played a great ball game. And the final again in double overtime. First time since 1913 we've had a multiple overtime basketball game in the state championship. Is 75-74 in double overtime. Joe Sex and I have thoroughly enjoyed it. Good luck to you and your Butler Bulldogs next year.
All right, thank you, Jerry.
And our thanks to Hilliard Gates, another pleasurable experience with you also tonight, Hilliard. Any reproduction of our telecast is strictly forbidden without the express written permission of the Indiana State High School Athletic Association, who also has approval of the announcers we use in our telecast. Final again in double overtime, 75-74. The Plymouth Pilgrims, for the first time in their school's history, are the state champions. This is Jerry Baker saying so long, everybody.
You've been watching another Indiana High School Athletic Association championship event.
Last time they put a championship trophy in the trophy case at Gary Roosevelt High School was 1968 when Bo Mallard took a ball club, made him 22-5. They lost five games also that year, and they beat Shortridge 68-60. And oddly enough, Roosevelt is 22-5 right now, looking for number 23. Knocked away. Great defensive play by Phil Wendell. He almost lost it. There's a scramble and a foul call against Roosevelt, and it's on Andre Anders. His first. But more importantly, for the Plymouth crowd watching this from up north, it will send Plymouth to the free throw line.
Guess who?
Scott Skiles will be there again. Scott hit his first two, then went on a cold streak, hitting only two of his next six, and has hit his last three in a row. He has 21 points tonight. He is the all-time leading scorer at Plymouth High School. They've had a couple of really good ones there over the years, including, of course, the young man whose record he broke, Steve Phillips. Bruce Grimm was also an outstanding all-star there. So Skiles gets a pair. He has now hit his last five free throws in a row. And he has 23 points. 55-54, Roosevelt by one with a minute 13 to play in the ball game. Inside they go to Thomas, and he slams down. Thomas with 16 and will stop the game while we bring the net down. That slam jam brought the net completely up over the edge of the rim. And very quickly, Gary Roosevelt's head coach, Ron Heflin, wants to make a substitution.
Let's watch this slam here now. He has 38, as Jerry said earlier. Make that 39.
He really can get up there, can he? Roosevelt jumps into a 3-2 zone, and really sets the way it looks from here with exactly a minute to go. 57-54. Roosevelt has the lead. Here is Samuelson. Can't get it. Rebounded by Renaldo Thomas. Lead pass quickly up court. Behind the back and a walking violation on Renaldo Thomas. And that was no time for the fancy Dan right there, Joe.
No, Renaldo got a little out of control there.
48 seconds remain. About the time you're ready to give the championship to Gary. Plymouth comes right back at him again. Whistle, ball, and I think it'll be on Plymouth's number 50, Jamie Johnson. Indeed. You see the clock superimposed at the bottom of your screen. It showed 41 seconds. And it's a three-point lead now for Gary Roosevelt. And a substitution again. Darrell Scott going out. Andre Anders coming in. And you see the Plymouth cheering section, led by their fine cheerleading squad, has not given up as of yet. They need a steal in a hurry.
Here's the situation you talked about. They're not shooting the one-on-one now. They're taking the ball out of bounds on the foul.
Oh, he kind of got himself up in the air and just let it fly, and they found a receiver. Oh, great defensive play. Sensational effort from Ron Sissel. Here is Skiles. Yes. Ron Sissel made a simply sensational play. Timeout called again. 26 seconds to play. Gary Roosevelt, 57. Plymouth, 56, and we'll return in a minute. Play of the game, Joe Sexton.
Ron Sissel.
He got all ball, too.
Might have been the game saver, or at least kept him alive in the
game. That's right. If Ronnie Bradley makes that, the trophy goes to Gary.
Ronnie Bradley inbounds. He's got it into Garland. Clock shows 24 seconds. They clear it up court to Andre Anders. Anders being chased out around the timeline. And number 20, Todd Samuelson, will try to reach in and make the steal. But, Joe, it doesn't make any difference. They still, it's only the third team foul against Plymouth. So they're still going to keep the basketball.
Exactly as you said earlier, it's really working against Plymouth now. They need to foul. Real quick.
Only 17 seconds, as you said.
Like you pointed out, they can take the chances now. They can dive for the ball and maybe come up with it. 17 seconds to play. Roosevelt has the lead, 57-56. They've got it inside. Back out to Garland. Down to 14, 13, 12, and a whistle and a foul again. And it's on Phil Wendell this time. And I've got him for five if that's on Phil.
That's on Phil. It's probably five, but even giving him two shots, Jerry, maybe an intentional foul right now is better for Plymouth than a one-on-one where they're not in the bonus yet.
I hadn't even thought about that. It's a reasonable chance for him to get a chance of a missed free throw.
If they make only one of the two, a field goal would tie the game.
Very good point, Joe.
It's a one-point lead for Gary Roosevelt. Difficult game to summarize if you see the handshakes given to Phil Wendell. Unless they can tie this. Well, of course, he's through. He won't be back. He's a senior, 5'11", had a great ball game. Goes out with 16 points. He had 8 this afternoon. His average is 17-6. Now, situation, Joe. Andre Anders is a 54% free throw shooter, but he was good on 4 out of 7 this afternoon. Here it is. Anders with 3 points. He scored 8 in the victory over Evansville. Bossy, and timeout is taken again. With 11 seconds to play, Gary Roosevelt leads Plymouth 58-56. One of your network sponsors is American Fletcher National Bank. Our coaching staff, Joe, just sort of like, can you get a shot of the Plymouth coaches over there?
Okay, you got one, man.
Chance, I want to show you the Plymouth coaches. Wow, they are relaxed. They're enjoying themselves. They're going to be eating themselves alive inside, though. Well, there's the two big buckets by Andre Anders. He has 4 points tonight. Quickly, Skiles. He got it. And timeout has been called with 5 seconds to go. Scott Skiles. 13 points in the period, 27 on the game. Now we'll peek into the Plymouth huddle. They're minus one man. Scott Skiles has gone to talk to the referee. He goes back into the huddle now.
With 4 fouls, the next one would be the 5th. It would be a 1-1, and I imagine they'll try to foul immediately, won't they, Joe?
They'll have to foul immediately.
I would have a suspicion. Here's this last basket again by Scott Skiles, Joe. I have a suspicion that might have been what Skiles had gone to tell the official. Look, when they get it, we're going to commit the foul. He wants to alert them, I assume, Joe. Is that, you do that when you're coaching?
He can do that. He certainly can do that. The thing of it is, they have to try to go for the ball, but if they miss the ball, then they have to foul. You see, the ideal thing now is to steal the basketball.
Right.
And get a basket, obviously. But they cannot allow any time to go off the clock with only 5 seconds. So if they dive for the ball and miss, someone has to foul that guy to get the inbounds pass.
What about fouling before the ball ever becomes live?
Possibility.
The ball's out of bounds. It's a technical foul if you foul with the ball out of bounds.
You lose the chance to get the steal, Jerry, if you do that. That's the only thing that you have to consider.
All right, Plymouth will be on the defense, and their score is simply this. As you see, one of the youngsters for Plymouth is not a particularly happy young man, but maybe he's given up the ghost too early. Roosevelt played a sensational basketball game. They lead 59-58 with 5 seconds remaining. They will have the ball under the Plymouth basket. They got a hurry to get it in. They call timeout, and they called it too late, I believe. Let me see, is it Plymouth basketball? So once the count reached 4 in the 5 count, you cannot call timeout.
That's
and
exactly
I'm not
right.
sure. They did timeout. Get the timeout. Oh, my, was that close. And right now, head coach Jack Edison of Plymouth is questioning that call. The situation is this, Joe, you can explain it. You got 5 seconds to toss it in, right?
That's right. It has to touch someone inbounds in 5 seconds.
And if once you reach the 4 count, you cannot
three,
call.
Right, unless you get past the 3. That's
right.
Exactly
you cannot
right.
call the timeout.
That's
and boy,
right.
that was really close right there. In fact, I thought the initial reaction was they had indeed disallowed the timeout. And there would have been a turnover, and Plymouth would have had the basketball. As it stands, of course, though, nothing happens on the clock. It doesn't start until somebody touches the ball inbounds. And a 59-58 score. Roosevelt still has the lead. 5 seconds remain. Same situation we had a minute ago with Roosevelt inbounding under the Plymouth bucket. It'll be Ronnie Bradley to try to throw it in. They do get it in, and a foul is called immediately on Scott Skiles, and 1 second ticked off the clock. That's the first foul tonight on Scott Skiles.
Outstanding job by the Panthers. They got the ball to Anthony Stewart, their fine free throw shooter.
And they're going to call it a two-shot foul, which will send Anthony Stewart to the line, Joe. He is their biggie. 91%, but as Hilliard pointed out, he's not been to the line that many times this year. He is 1 out of 2 tonight. Well, they got a couple of big ones from Andre Anders a few minutes ago. You see the conversation between Todd Samuelson of Plymouth and head coach Jack Edison. Well, Jack, 37 years of age, married, wife Judy, and he have a couple of youngsters, Lisa 9 and Michael 5, a graduate of Green Township High School and Bethel College. Whoa, look at here. It looks like that Plymouth has one more timeout remaining. So they're probably going to take it right here no matter what happens. If they get the rebound. They will take the timeout. Anthony Stewart connects, and we'll take a moment. Thank the folks who helped to make our telecast possible tonight. Our executive producer is Michael Davis. Tonight's telecast produced by Bill Nichols and Jim Butler. Directed by Peter Mago. Our network coordinator was Dean McDowell. Slow motion replay, Dick Blair. Video by Jim Miller, Ken Hodgson, and Harold Reitner, who've done a great job with us all year long. Audio, Fred Lawrence and Chris Palmer. Cameras, Mike Pope, Susan Reese, Bob DeLong, and Jeff Reiner. Floor directors, Eddie Swanson and Debbie Orr. Our thanks to those two. Graphics by Mark Emmons and Bud Bray. And our statistician tonight was Andy Dietrich. Ladies and gentlemen, one and all, Hilliard and Joe and I thank you for a job exceedingly well done.
Right. Joe, do you tell your team don't foul now under any conditions?
Well, we saw this happen this afternoon. There was one more second. Remember, Renaldo got the ball one-third of the court, one-third of the way up the court, dribbled all the way down and scored. There was still 1 second. Then the time ran out. I would say from that this afternoon, what you have to do, you can't foul, obviously. But what you have to do is slow them up before. And then you see Gary is at midcourt now. The Panthers are. They'll let him throw it in back that way farther, but not closer to their basket.
They just put Kenny McKinney 6'4 in to guard the man inbounding the ball.
Gary Roosevelt looking for a second state championship. They got it to Skiles. 20-footer. It's good!
Can you believe it?
Scott Skiles hits it at the buzzer, and we go to overtime.
Ball to the player they wanted to shoot it.
That's right.
Look at this again, Joe Simpson.
Watch this pass. It's going to go into Todd Samuelson, 20. He turns and throws it right up the floor as hard as he can. And here goes Scott Skiles with one second when he lets it go.
About 23 feet away.
Boom. Well, I'll tell you something.
you bought a ticket today to any of these games and you ain't happy, and you're just a stroke shy of being dead, because it has been a beauty. What a sensational full day of basketball. Earlier today, Plymouth beats Cathedral in a barn burner. Dylan, a last second shot. Roosevelt beats Evans Bell Boston. We're at 60-60 and we're going to overtime. Scott Skiles had a sensational fourth period. Five field goals and five out of six in the free throw line. He had a 16-point fourth period. You give him 30 on the night, and that's what he had this afternoon. He has been unbelievable.
Joe, that had to be a set situation. They must practice that, because they did it methodically, and it was like a wing back going down under a long pass.
And that's the right. Players, oddly enough, I don't know if you saw it, the players were talking to each other. They knew exactly what they wanted done out there.
You guys act real surprised, but you practice those things all the time.
But they never work.
They don't? Did you just see that?
I saw it. You're right. In fact, I saw it happen twice today. Unbelievable basketball game. We're in overtime. Roosevelt lost a 7-point lead. Plymouth lost a 12-point lead. We're at 60-60 with 3 minutes of playing time, less right now. And a foul on Skiles.
Foul on Skiles.
That is two on Scott. Now keep in mind, Plymouth is playing without its starting guard, Bill Wendell, who fouled out in the final couple of minutes of regulation time. And in the lineup is Mark Stukenborg, along with Jamie Johnson, two non-starters. Also in the lineup, Skiles and Ron Sissel and Todd Samuelson. Anthony Stewart, good free throw shooter. Boy, Anthony Stewart, Joe Sexton's had a marvelous day. I've got him down for 2, 4, 5, 16 points in this game. Make it 15. 62-60, Roosevelt with a 2-point lead, 2.5 minutes, 2:35 to play to be more precise, in overtime session number one. Samuelson, number 20, playing at a guard spot, left side of Jamie Johnson. Oh, great defensive play by Winston Garland. Garland on a great defensive effort brings it across the time. Samuelson cannot get the steal. They swing it right side to Darryl Scott. Now they start to spread the floor out a little bit. Garland. Winston Garland made the steal and got the hoop. And it's a 4-point lead for Roosevelt in overtime. A minute 51 seconds to play. 64-60. Gary Roosevelt out in front. Skiles inside. Great move down the lane. Give the hook to number 50, Jamie Johnson. And for Jamie, his first 2 points of the entire game. Whoa! My goodness. The Plymouth player crashed across that first table and hit his head. That's Skiles, put his head on the second table. It's a two-row situation just to our left. He just cracked his head there.
No question about the effort given by both teams here. That's a good example right there, Scott Skiles.
I don't know where they found it, Joe. Both ball clubs were dragging in the first half. The old adrenaline has really got to be pumping out there. These guys are going to collapse when this baby's over. 1 minute, 25 seconds to play in overtime. Whistle, foul against Roosevelt.
Anthony.
Number 11, Anthony Stewart with four. And Plymouth's got a chance to tie the ball game again. If you walk away from your set for one split second, you have just missed an unbelievable finish to what looked to be a ball game that was over. 2-point lead, Roosevelt. Plymouth ball under the Roosevelt basket. They throw up 3/4 of the length of the court. Skiles makes a 20-footer, and we go to overtime. And Todd Samuelson is at the free throw line. He's run out of two from the line tonight. Rebound picked off on the near side by Mark Stukenborg. Keep him enough corner is Skiles. They can't get it to him. Now they do. Great pass. Sensational pass from Todd Samuelson. Skiles now with 32 points. 1 minute to play. Tie ball game at 64. 55 seconds to go. Garland. Off to Dorsey or to Anders. Anders penetrating and swings it back outside. 40 seconds to play in the game. Both cheering sections standing behind us to see it win, to see it black and gold. In the lower right-hand corner of your screen, that's the official scoreboard clock you're seeing. A foul on Johnny Bradley. Bradley going over the back, tried three tips and didn't get it, and commits his third personal foul.
That was tough luck for Bradley there. He made two great efforts on the offensive board.
He really did a good job here, Joe.
There's the shot. He misses that one. One of the few he has missed. Keeps it alive. Still goes after it. There's the foul over the back.
And Ron Sissel, the 6'2 senior starting center, who has scored 4 points, all of them in the first half, is at the free throw line. He is a 66% shooter. He did not go to the line in this afternoon's game. He has just called Plymouth to within one of Gary Roosevelt with 19 seconds to play in overtime. Now you probably put him ahead by one. They've got a one-point lead. 15 seconds to go. Plymouth up by one. The game is tied at 64. Here is Garland again. Won't go. Rebound by Plymouth. Knocked out of bounds. And off the leg of Scott Skiles, and Roosevelt's got it again. 6 seconds remain. If Skiles gets that rebound, Joe, there would have been a celebration starting in Plymouth, perhaps.
A thin, thin margin between victory and defeat here.
1 point lead for Plymouth. 65-64. They get it inbounds, and a whistle and a foul on Jamie Johnson. And that is the second on Jamie. That's not even significant whatsoever. What is significant now is that Roosevelt goes to the free throw line, trailing by one with 3 seconds left.
Renaldo Thomas has a chance to do it again.
Thomas, in case you missed it today, scored the winning bucket with no time left on the clock as they came up with the victory over Evansville Bussy, the number one undefeated team in the state of Indiana. Here he is, Renaldo Thomas, number 13. Already headed for the University of San Francisco when school is out. Thomas now has 17 points and a timeout has been called. With 3 seconds remaining in overtime, 65 tie, and we'll continue after these messages. Along with Joe Setchman and Hilliard Gates at Market Square Arena. In overtime, with 3 seconds to go, tie ball game at 65. And this is Ronaldo Thomas at the free throw line for the Roosevelt Panthers, trying to give him the lead. He didn't get it. It's tapped around. 2 seconds, 1 second, double overtime. Double overtime. 65-65 is the time. We'll go one more overtime session, and we're going to stay right here. And, Joe, would you, in the minute we have, recap the game from start to finish? You know something? You remember a few years ago when we worked my first sectional of our state championship, Terre Haute South, with that crazy shot by, I've forgotten his name now, for Terre Haute South, and we had the same thing happen with the championship game.
Will Ussel.
We had a sensational game that night. We've had three of these things today.
Well, we had three of them last Saturday in Fort Wayne at the semi-state, and Plymouth was involved in two of them.
All right, let's take it start to finish. First quarter, Plymouth up by 12. They lead 22-14 at the end of the first quarter. At halftime, the lead was chopped to 5, 30-25. In the third period, Plymouth went out of gas a little bit. They fell behind by 7, trailed 45-38 after 3. Then, with Only a couple of seconds showing on the clock. Scott Skiles hit one to tie it to send it into overtime at 60 all. We played three more minutes. It is still tied at 65-65. We're in the second overtime for the state championship. Three more minutes or more. The tap goes completely out of bounds. I believe it'll belong to Plymouth under their own hoop. I wonder what Plymouth will do, Joe, if they get a lead. You think they might sit on it? Roosevelt didn't. Hard to say right now.
It is hard to say.
Second overtime session. Plymouth with the basketball. Here is Skiles. Oh, he's double, triple team. Black and gold all over him. Takes it anyway and scores.
You can't ever leave him.
Scott Skiles has, what is that, Hilliard? 34 points or so for Scott. Maybe 36. I'll have to add him up here real quickly. A steal by Plymouth. Now we'll get a chance to see. Here's Skiles dishing it off. 2 points for Mark Stukendorf. His fourth point of the game.
Great pass from Skiles. Just the opposite of the first overtime when the Panthers scored the first 4 points.
Now then, Plymouth's got a four-point lead. As Joe said, it, a mirror image of what happened in the first overtime period. And Roosevelt got the first two hoops. They come back and get one at the other end. Darryl Scott. Scott getting his fourth point of the game. 2:05 to play in overtime.
They may have to call this because of daylight.
We're going to have a true winner, someone that really deserves the state championship.
I have Skiles for 35 points.
Right.
There he is again. Skiles, he won't get it, but he'll go to the line. And the foul is called against number 14 of Roosevelt, Darryl Scott. Third against Darryl. Reminder again now. Bill Wendell of Plymouth is out of the ball game. He fouled out in regulation time. So Plymouth is working without their regular dynamic duo at guard, Bill Wendell and Scott Skiles. But Skiles has done a sensational job of filling that void. He goes to the free throw line.
Well, you know, for a period there, he wasn't getting the ball up to the basket. He was so tired. He's got his second win now. Let's see what he does with these two.
I don't know where the entire ball club, Joe, got their second win somewhere along the way. They started out red hot tonight. And appear to, as the game wound down, they began to wind down. And somewhere in that third period, after they were down by seven, something happened to this ball club, and they have just taken on a totally new outlook. Plymouth now is up by four again, 71-67. They average 76 points a game, so this score is nothing new to them. 1 minute, 44 seconds to play. 71-67. Plymouth out in front of Gary Roosevelt. And over, the basket's going to count, and the foul is called against Plymouth. Darryl Scott gets the hoop. Let's check and see who the guilty party is on the personal foul.
All right, here's the shot right there by Winston Garland. Watch this rebound. Beautiful.
Scott has both field goals in the overtime period. Foul is on Stukenborn. And number 14, Darryl Scott, wants to go to the bench and get his glasses wiped off. Gary Roosevelt was preseason ranked number 7 by AP, number 11 by UPI. They finished up unranked as they had some troubles, losing 5 ball games, won by a, and being taken away from them by an ineligible player, a forfeit. Plymouth wound up ranked 4th in the state in both of the polls. 3-point play. Darryl Scott, he has all 5 of Roosevelt's points in overtime number 2. 71-70 with a minute 25 to go. Skiles inside. He got it again. Skiles has scored 6 points in overtime. 6 of the 8 for Plymouth. 1:15 to play. 2 more at the other end from Anthony Stewart.
Unbelievable. Absolutely unbelievable.
Wonderful.
This kind of pressure, these kids have are just shooting lights out at Market Square Arena. This may go down as one of the finest championship games in the history of this great sport. Oh, what a great save on a bubble by Mark Stukenborn. They drop it inside. Johnson's in trouble, comes back out to Stukenborn. 51 seconds to play. Samuelson, 73-72. The lead belongs to Plymouth. They had a 4-point lead at the start of the period. Here is the foul on Anthony Stewart, and he is gone.
Stewart has just fouled out. And Joe, let's give this young man all the credit in the world. He had 14 points off the bench this afternoon. 2, 4, 6, 7. I have him for 18 tonight.
He's had a great tournament. Obviously, he's just peaking here. And this is the perfect time for it.
And the Plymouth players are standing up and giving Anthony Stewart an ovation. I don't know when I've ever seen that before in a game that isn't over yet anyway.
There's a lot of things we haven't seen before, I think, in the state tournament game. We've had so much good play from a team standpoint, and then so many great individual plays. That's all you can ask for.
Stukenborg is only a 60% free throw.
Here we go, number 44, Mark Stukenborg. He couldn't get it. And the rebound comes off to Roosevelt. They trail by one, 73-72. 35 seconds to play in the second overtime period. Power move inside and a foul on Jamie Johnson. They got it where they wanted it. Ronnie Bradley to our network stations all throughout the Midwest. Obviously, we'll be a little late getting off the air tonight. We don't know when we're going to get out of here, as a matter of fact, so please bear with us. Everything is going along so well. Time-wise, I'm talking about. And these two ball clubs just have not wanted to pack it up and head back north again. Here is Ronnie Bradley, a 38% shooter. He is 0 for 2 from the line tonight. You realize if he makes this, we might be looking at the third overtime session. I've got no place to go. I don't know about you guys.
They can play as long as they want, as far as I'm concerned.
I'll stay here watching.
I got to go to Dallas next Saturday.
Next Saturday? We'll get you there. Oh, an air ball. Ronnie Bradley put one up, and the elbow just kind of locked on him. Now then, let's see what's going to happen. Timeouts. Roosevelt has three. Plymouth has one. They're not going to use them right now, though. Plymouth had everybody on the end of the floor to get the ball inbounds. They do. Scott Skiles almost kicked it away. Manages to make the save and is fouled by number four, Andre Anders. And that's not really too bad a foul, Joe. Maybe the wrong guy to foul, but they need to stop the clock right now.
Don't have any choice. That's right. They don't have a choice of who to foul because, as we have looked at the game in the last few times up the court for Plymouth, there's only one guy that's had the ball. That's Scott Skiles.
Skiles is 2 out of 2 in the second overtime session. He had 2 points in the first overtime. He has 6 in the overtime period number 2. And I mentioned about the relaxed atmosphere on the coaching benches across the way. And to be quite honest, both of the benches have been very relaxed tonight. Ooh, he got it. It didn't look real pretty, but it rolled inside. 24 seconds remain. Roosevelt 72, Plymouth 74. Plymouth will take the timeout. Now Roosevelt takes the timeout. They're down to 2 now. You take my word for it. Now, that's Gary Roosevelt, huddled around head coach Ron Heflin in his 8th year at Roosevelt. He had a record of 121 wins and 46 losses coming into tonight's game. Lionel Boone, Glenn Miller, Benny Dorsey are helping him out. At the other end of the floor, Plymouth around head coach Jack Edison in his 9th year, a record of 148 wins, 65 losses. Mike Pettibone out of Ball State, Tom Eisenbarger from Butler are down there as they go through the strategy for the final 24 seconds.
Well, the American League has the designated hitter. I think the IHSAA is going to have the designated announcer rule.
It's about gone here.
He's bounced from football to baseball, and he gives a 2-minute drill this afternoon. You're on it right now tonight, you know, Neil.
Well, let's see here. Scott Skiles, 6'1 senior, top scorer in the state of Indiana, averaging 28.8, 30 points this afternoon. I've run out of how many he's got tonight. Skiles hits an all-important one.
A little full court pressure to slow up the Panthers. Didn't slow them up at all.
39 for Skiles. In the corner, Garland, or I should say Dorsey, missing and a foul on the rebound. And it is against Roosevelt.
Unbelievable.
It is on Darryl Scott. Number 4 on Darryl Scott.
Darryl doesn't have any choice there. There's the shot went up from Andre Anders. Right there it is. There's the foul going over the back. Ron Sissel will be shooting.
Skiles, 30 points this afternoon. He has 39 tonight. He is the all-time leading scorer at Plymouth High School.
I believe 40 is the record, Jerry, for the championship game. David Shepard holds that, I believe.
Rebound picked off with a missed shot that time from Ron Sissel. Roosevelt in a hurry, down to 10 seconds to play. Inside, great power move and timeout call. Ronaldo Thomas getting his first 2 points in the second overtime. Ronaldo tonight has 19, his average is 17-9. So with 7 seconds remaining, it's 75-74 Plymouth.
David Shepard is in the audience tonight, seated up behind us.
He's got to be thinking about that a little bit.
Right, 40 points.
What a day we have had. It began at 10:30 this morning, and for Hilliard and Joe and I, it really hasn't stopped since then. We've been going full steam ahead, and it's a lot of work, but I'll tell you, I've loved every second of this.
You can't, you really can't write a script like this. That's trite to say, but when you have talent both on the bench coaching and talent on the court, you frequently have a tremendous contest, and this is one of the all-time greats, I'm sure.
And you know, the folks at the Indiana High School Athletic Association, Ward Brown and his people, Hilliard, even though they're not playing or even very much in obvious appearance, they've got to take a certain amount of pride in this also.
All right.
It has been a very well officiated, a very well run, and just a darn good basketball championship.
That's a good point, Jerry. I think the officials deserve a lot of credit because there have been a lot of situations that have come up. They've done a nice job.
1 point lead for Plymouth. They got the ball inbounds. Oh, they've got it. Three seconds. Two. One. It's over. Plymouth has won the state championship since 1913, when that game went 5 overtime. We are told by Herb Fulmeyer, who knows about everything there is to know about high school basketball. Hilliard Gates has left us at courtside and has fought his way out onto the floor. We will try to get what we can for you. Our apologies to our network stations. We just simply no way in the world we can leave this kind of a situation. Hilliard now trying to get some help as he rounds up the coach. He now has him in hand. Hilliard Gates, courtside, with Jack Edison, the head coach of the Plymouth Pilgrims.
Jack, I know you're overwhelmed. I'm overwhelmed. I've seen 5,500 basketball games that I've broadcast. I don't remember anything like this. This is unbelievable. Congratulations.
Thank you. It's just a great thrill, you know, and I'm just very, very happy for the kids and for the fans. And I'll tell you something, boy, Gary Roosevelt is some kind of a team. They came out this second half, and I think they outplayed us defensively. They really worked hard defensively and played very smart, and they just deserve an awful lot of credit. Of course, I'm very proud of our kids, too.
Where did they get the second win? They were tired at the end of the first half.
I don't know. Both teams, I know you're talking about, had, I think both teams just showed an awful lot of heart. And they just, both teams, I think, deserve a lot of credit because, like you say, it's almost an inhuman thing to be able to put out that much. And I think both schools have to be very proud of their young men.
We talked about the margin of victory and defeat being so slim and so small.
I'm not sure what the word is, Hilliard, but you just have to be very, very fortunate. You know, I believe very strongly in God and the Lord. I'm not saying he wins games and things, but I think he helps me relax a little bit on the floor. But you have to be fortunate to win these kinds.
Well, congratulations. They want to get on with the ceremony. We're running late. Congratulations.
Thank you very much, Hilliard.
Great following your marvelous team and your fine young people.
Thank you very much.
Scott Skiles. Scott, we're running late. I don't remember performances like this. Very, very seldom do you see what you did out here today. This is just a magnificent climax to your great career.
Yeah, it is. This is great. I was hoping before the year we could at least get down here. I'm just glad we won.
Well, you talked about possible state championship last week in Fort Wayne.
Yeah. I don't know if I really believe that or not, but I do now.
Are you tired?
No, I'm exhausted.
Where did you get the extra breath? Where did you get the win?
I don't know. When you're playing in front of 17,000 people for the state championship, it's not that hard to keep playing. I'll be dead this morning, though. Tomorrow morning.
Congratulations.
Thanks.
Get on with the ceremony. All right, back to you, Jerry.
Thank you, Hilliard. If some of the stations have to leave us along the way, well, that's their prerogative, but we're going to stay here until we are told by our officials here that we should cut away. And dependent upon how smoothly things go, while we are getting Gary Roosevelt up to pick up their medallions and their honors, Joe, you've been down this road before.
Yeah. Unfortunately, I was right there where those young men are.
It's a bittersweet situation,
and
is it not?
Oh, especially after the tremendous effort that they gave. And, you know, coming in here with the worst record and then going down the wire and getting beat on a, or having to go into overtime on a last second shot when it looked like they had the ball game won and the state championship won. That makes it even that much more difficult.
I will give you the scoring while they're handing out the medallions. So the runner-up, Gary Roosevelt, Panthers, Plymouth Legends, going by Scott Skiles with 39 points, including 8 points in the second overtime. 8 of the 10 they scored. Also scoring in double figures, Phil Wendell, who fouled out in regulation time. They played all the overtime sessions without him. He had 16 tonight. 9 points from Todd Samuelson, 5 from Rod Sissel, 4 off the bench from Mark Stukenborg, and 2 from Jamie Johnson. Roosevelt, 19 points from Ronaldo Thomas. He led the way. Other double-figure scoring, Anthony Stewart off the bench with 18. 10 points from Winston Garland. And other scoring, 7 points from Darrell Scott, 4 out of Andre Anders, and 2 points out of David Dorsey. And the coaching staff now of Gary Roosevelt, head coach Ron Heflin, Ronald Broom, Glenn Miller, Benny Dorsey, all receiving their congratulations, handshakes, and bearer up bronze medals, runner-up medals presented by Gunther Herzog of Fort Wayne Concordia, chairman of the IHSAA Executive Committee, and Paul Rommelman of Counts, vice chairman of the IHSAA Executive Committee. Now the presentation of the runner-up trophy by Bill Shepard, athletic director at Carmel High School. There is a very proud group of young men. It's difficult for them right now. And indeed, I guess, Joe, you never quite get that sting out of your mind. But when you figure the season started and there were 395 and you finished number 2, that ain't bad.
That is real good, but it lives with you as long as you live. And that you are so close, but you didn't get it.
75-74 in double overtime, Plymouth has beaten Gary Roosevelt. And let me be quite honest, this Plymouth basketball team is a sensational one. And Joe, I think you and I will agree, if we're perfectly honest, that when they came rolling in here this morning, we didn't really, based on the statistics and their height disadvantage, give them a great deal of a chance of winning this state championship.
Well, of course, we'll have to qualify it a little bit, Jerry, in the fact that you and I saw Cathedral play so well in the semi-state last week. And then with the tremendous height advantage, as you say, with Kenny Barlow especially, we didn't really see how they were going to be able to handle him on the board.
And that's not being critical of Plymouth at all. It's trying to be objective and assess what you're going to talk about during the telecast of a basketball game. And they were just sensational today. Folks in Plymouth can really be proud of these young men because when it looked like they were out of gas, they found something somewhere along the way. Now the ovation for the Gary Roosevelt Panthers, runners up. For the second time, they were runners-up in 55 at Christmas Attucks, the Oscar Robertson, Willie Merriweather team, when they lost 97-74. Now here come the state champion, Plymouth Pilgrims. They will now take the stand at center court. Let's join Tom Carnegie if we can. Again, we'll stay with this as long as we can. Come the Plymouth Pilgrims, the 1982 Indiana High School Athletic Association Boys State Basketball Champions. Hilliard Gates, you're down on the floor right close to the emotion. What's it like out there?
Well, it's,
I don't think I've seen a more emotionally spent team than the Gary Roosevelt team. They were weeping bitterly, but they were embraced proudly by members of the administrative staff, by the assistant coaches and the head coach. They're trying to get their emotions back together. Now the elation begins here. This is an emotion of joy. And now here's a proud move. Ron Heflin, the coach of Gary Roosevelt, is shaking hands with every member of the Plymouth Pilgrims.
That is an act I don't know if I've seen before, Hilliard. That took a lot of courage on his part. The championship trophy, the championship medals, presentations by Don Elder of Monroe Central and David Herbert of Mitchell, Indiana. And then we'll have the presentation of the championship trophy and the prestigious Kressler Award. Halftime, you saw some of the former Kressler Award winners, one of which is my partner sitting to my right, Joe Sexton.
Scott Skiles, Phil Wendell.
Well, he had a good ball game today.
Larry Johns, Todd Samuelson, Mark Stukenborg. Holland, Jamie Johnson, here is Coach Jack Edison, Assistant Coach Mike Pettibone, Assistant Coach Tom Eisenbarger, Pinkerton, the principal, and the athletic director, Ron.